Hey, everybody. I'm really excited and privileged to be able to interview some new friends of ours, friends that you probably will really recognize the name, maybe not quite recognize the face because they've been hiding their faces from us for so many years. But this is Nestor and Tony and Quelan. Okay. And where you've heard that name, of course, is in Raymond Franz, Crisis of Conscience. They were actually friends, personal friends with Raymond, and you remember what was mentioned in that. We'll briefly talk about that. But first, what we wanted to do is just to talk with them a little bit about how they woke up and about something exciting. And the exciting thing is about a book that's coming out. And what did you tell me the name of the book was?
Helping Others.
Helping Others. And you're also a life coach today by profession.
Yes.
Okay. And one thing I found very interesting, too, that I think more of us wish, as far as the XJW community, wish we could do is when we would leave, we wish probably we could have just walked right away and started living our lives. But so many have spent some time, a year, 2 years, 10 years, whatever, and then finally some of them get to leave. But y'all went ahead and pursued your careers, correct? Mm-hmm. And you did real estate, Tony?
Yes, I've been doing real estate since 1988.
Okay.
Yes, and I was working in the insurance industry.
Okay, insurance and real estate. Okay, and so a little bit of background. I know that you were what, a district overseer for the whole country of Spain?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, you know, I've got a friend from Spain. She may not ever watch this because she's still an active Jehovah's Witness, but her name's Peggy and Tommy. This brother here is why you probably had congregations here, because her, you know, parents grew and grandparents during the time of the Civil War.
Yeah.
Very. But tell us a little bit about while you were over there, what the conditions was like.
Okay. We were married in 1964 in Puerto Rico. We are from Puerto Rico, and then in 1967 we went to Gilead. From Gilead, we were assigned to work in Spain. That was during the Franco regime. He was a dictator and a real dictator. So we used to work underground. We spent 10 years in Spain, and we were there always illegally. We have to go every 6 months to a border in Spain to go out of the country, have our passport signed, and return the same day. So if they caught us, at least we were tourists, legally tourists. We entered the country legally. But when we were there, we were assigned to the circuit work. It was a little harder than in the States or free countries because the work was banned. We worked underground. So the organization was quite different, very hard to visit the congregation in small group. We couldn't meet more than 20 people in a place without asking permission to the government. So we couldn't ask permission. We were illegal. The only religion was Jehovah's Witnesses. So we worked in the circuit work.
Your religion was Catholic.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah.
Yeah. What did I say?
You said Jehovah's Witnesses.
Oh. Still here. No, Catholic. The Catholic Church. So first, we did the circuit work in a section of Madrid and Extremadura and Castilla la Vieja. And later on, we did the district work. I was the only district overseer for the whole country, plus the islands, Canary Islands and the Balearic Islands and Andorra, small country, going to France. And then I was the instructor for the elders, the Kingdom Ministry School. And I used to work also in the service department. So it was many things. But it was most of the time in the field.
Spain was one of the places where
yes.
The school for the elders.
We used to go to Seville. But I spent most of my time outside the branch, in the field with the brothers. I had the opportunity to really train the members of the congregation and the elders.
and what was it like for women working uh-huh. there underground, Tony?
Well, it wasn't easy, but it was great. I mean, the brothers were very grateful that we were there, and we felt that love, and so that made it easier. The weather was also kind of harsh sometimes because the conditions weren't correct. I mean, like you didn't have heaters in the homes or even hot water sometimes. So in the wintertime, that made it harder.
And I read about how having food in this one house. You couldn't cook or prepare food in the one house you stayed at. Or is that a different place?
Is that because the water got?
Oh yes. Because the pipes would freeze at night, and then they would defrost in the morning, and then they would freeze again in the afternoon, and like that all day for a week. Wow. Yeah. So it was hard to do anything, and no water practically. But they worked hard, and everybody did. So you got in the spirit of it, and that's what counted. And I enjoyed it very much. The brothers were very loving. And it's funny, although we were underground, but we were never scared. We just went on. We felt that we were being guarded in a way. And the brothers would do everything they could to help us so that if there was anything that was kind of shady or some police was nearby, they would right away they would warn us and cover us and make sure that we were well. So
I read that you compared that to like a spiritual paradise that you were at compared to a jungle that you later went to. So what do you call the jungle? What do you call the jungle?
I would say Bethel was a jungle.
Yeah, the point is that I mentioned in the book that we were living in a paradise.
Yes.
We always felt like that. We were in a spiritual paradise. But when we came to Bethel, things changed. And the reason I mentioned that we were like in a paradise is because we were in the position to train, to help others. And my theme was always to be kind and to be happy, to apply the Bible principles in our own life first, so that we could be happy, and then apply the legal stuff in a kind way. Because the brothers, when we got there, they were very legalistic because they were living in a dictator, and things were very legal. And the watchtower is the same, or worse.
I think you compared it to like living in a prison or in a military because everybody made you what? Uniform, cut the hair a certain way. You didn't have your individualism like you had in Spain, correct?
Yeah. So in Spain, we were free in a way, helping brothers, helping other people, always with the congregational issues. But since I used to apply love and kindness, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I wasn't, and I helped others to do it. I could see the changes. Even today, I receive emails from people who are in the organization, people who are ex-witnesses, mentioning their experience with us in the Kingdom Ministry School for the elders, how they enjoy seeing the organization in a different way. But then, hard for me, when I went to Bethel, that vision changed. Because I got in a place that was like a prison. Since day first that you get there, they give you instruction, trust instructions, and a meeting on Monday telling you how to act, how to do things.
Wow.
And
just like the bunker videos, you being under under in the bunker.
Yeah. Wow. And at that time, I was 4 years old. And we want to do certain things in our way, so we have to go out to get my hair cut, because in Bethel they used to give you haircut, really bad ones, crew cuts. So everybody looks
same
the same.
Clothes, same kind of clothes.
No, not the same. But you have to wear when you used to go out.
And the people out around.
Yes, and we have to wear those white shirt with the tie. And even, I remember once that Tony and I were walking in the street and we start fooling around, that's from Bethel, that's from Bethel, that's from Bethel. Because we were able to identify their personality, uniformity, that's the word, That's the best word for me.
Not united,
to use
uniform.
Uniformity, Bethel. You have
so
to.
If you had your choice today, if you were in the organization to serve in Russia with their band or in Bethel, which would you pick?
Russia. I like liberty and freedom.
And the thing is from what I remember reading about in the book, and everyone's will remember, is you when you two were disfellowshipped. I want to talk a little bit briefly about the events that led up to that. First of all, y'all had went over and talked to some, just a visit, dinner, correct, with Raymond Franz, and because there are a couple others. And
I will put this in place.
Sure. Tell us.
Anthony. Okay. Well, first, after 3 years in Bethel, I started seeing and thinking that the Holy Spirit was not there. I was convinced of that. I saw so many things, the way they treated others, the way
politics,
everything, immorality, alcohol, and especially the way they treated others. The young fellows that get in Bethel, that they were young, happy, and suddenly they had to adapt to a cold and strict place. And they used to receive a lot of advice not to be so friendly, so happy, and to
suicide. You knew suicide.
Yes, yes. Somebody when I was there, people get suicide and made plenty of things. But mainly was the working condition. They were working like slaves.
Yes.
From 8 to 12, from 1 to 20 to 6, they go to the congregation, return the next day. I wasn't aware of that after. I would say recently that I started reading about cults, how they do that to keep you busy and not to think. See, that's why I mentioned that it was like a prison. And also you mentioned I started thinking that way because the condition that I saw. And I started talking to Tony about this. And finally I talked to my friend Cristobal Sanchez. No. Cristobal. Okay, he was another translator with more experience than me in Bethel and a good translator for Spanish. And I talked to him one day. I said, I don't think the Holy Spirit is in this place. I don't think so. And he told me, well, Nestor, if you want to talk about this, talk to René Vasquez. He has been talking with Raymond lately about some things that you may be interested in. So I called René, and René told me a few things. It was by phone, and I was talking from in the same floor that I worked, in the floor in the factory. So René told me, yes, Nestor, we have to get together and talk about this, because the teaching of the 144 is not like that. The remnant teaching, the 144,000, and the remnant, yeah. The faithful and discreet slave is not as they say. Say what? Because I always thought that was the main teaching, no? If you believe that, you are in the cult. If not, you are out.
Yeah, you have to uniformity. You have to believe everything, whether you like it or not. You can't one thing doctrine you can't change. For those that's watching that don't know anything about Jehovah's Witnesses, that you can't disagree with one thing, or you're. Our way or the highway, as they say.
But the reason why they are going able to do that is because once you believe that there is a faithful and discreet slave on earth that is dispensing, giving the food at the right time from God, then you believe it.
Chain of command.
Yeah, what they say comes from God. So I was shocked, and it made sense to me immediately. That information. It hit me. And then I called Raymond and we spoke several times by phone. He gave me some good arguments, some scripture to think about. And I mentioned to Tony, this is it. I don't like this. And Tony said, okay, I don't like it neither. Because we discussed it.
But you were planning on just fading, right?
Yes.
Not to publicly, but because you had family. You had
Tony
explained
that.
Your dad.
Yeah. And I also had certain incidents that I was not happy where I was working. Because some people, I don't know, they get like paranoia. And I noticed a lot of the women, would come by. They would talk to me about how they felt. They wanted to have a family. They wanted to be normal. And they felt that this was not, that Bethel was anything but normal, especially for women, because we don't count, even no matter how, no matter what you did or how smart you were. It was always under a man's command, and so they always got all the attention, and the women were just there to please the men, I guess. Yes, yes. So I told my husband that I was not happy, and I really wanted to leave. And we had already decided that, and we had put in our resignation at Bethel. We were going to leave within a month's time, something like that.
You're still doing your job.
Yes, we were doing our job.
Not doing anything wrong or immoral
no.
or anything.
No.
So many of our friends, this is what happened too.
Right, right. And then we took vacation. After Nestor spoke with Ray, we took a 2-week vacation that we had coming to us. So before we left, we said, might as well take it. And we discussed a lot what Raymond had explained to us and what we saw in the Bible. And we were both convinced at the same time. So we said, well, we don't want to harm anybody. We don't want to do anything drastic. But it's better if we leave. And then we fade away. And that would have been, that's
mom,
the way
your
we.
Mom and dad both.
Yes, yes. My parents, my dad was a circuit overseer. And at that time, he was a special pioneer in Georgia. And they were very gung-ho with the congregation. And my brother, too. And so we didn't want to just cut off with them. So that's why we thought, let's just fade away and then just be happy our way. And we thought of going back to Spain, but we didn't have money to do that. So we decided to go back to Puerto Rico.
So you had positions in Puerto Rico, too, didn't you, in the society there?
Well, when we were in Puerto Rico, oh, yes, when we were in Puerto Rico, I was a special pioneer and a congregation servant okay. in a small congregation that we were sent
so you
to help.
A lot of friends in Puerto Rico.
Oh, yes,
before,
yes, many people.
I met Nestor, I was okay. a special pioneer, and I started a congregation okay. in a little town called Comerillo. Uh-huh. Yeah. So, yeah, we had a lot
of
friends.
Today don't know what special pioneers are. I grew up having some good like mothers to me, spiritual moms and dads that were special pioneers. Mm-hmm. And they're special. Matter of fact, I've still got some that's still in it. Matter of fact, one of them is his name, Eddie. I said, I sure hope you don't get fired with them laying off all the special pioneers. And he's living in a little apartment house behind the Kingdom Hall. And he said, I don't know what they'd do if they can't. I don't have no place to go. I just guess I'll have to lay down and die. You know, because he's elderly now and everything, too.
I don't know. I never asked either, you know, how it was in the States. But in Puerto Rico, we used to get $32.50 a month. Yeah. And
you expect to buy your clothing and everything else
out of that. We paid rent $15. Yeah. And we were lucky that we would go out in the country and people would give us fruits and eggs and things like that. And we exchanged them for the magazines. And that's how we could get along in a way. And then I always remember this one man who had a grocery store. And he took a liking to us, although he didn't want to be a Jehovah's Witness. But he would always tell us, you buy here with or without money. Don't worry about it. Because they knew what our situation was. Mm-hmm. So it's always been hard to be a pioneer.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So the point is that, yes, in Puerto Rico, as a matter of fact, everybody knew us because in one of the international district assemblies, I gave the public talk. And, we have a name there because being from a small country and being missionaries in Spain with all those titles.
That's the whole issue because everybody knew you. Everybody looked up to you. Everybody respected you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They would not let you fade. And when I say that, a watchtower, they wanted to make an example out of you two. Mm-hmm. And how they made an example, when I read the story, it just how they come in like an army, wasn't it? Just all at once and talk down to you and belittled you and... Tell
that's something that I want to tell. The day when we returned to Bethel, we were not the same people anymore. Mentally, internally. We knew we were going to leave. We had already planned that we were going to leave and fade. But something happened. One morning, we go to the job, and they came a group of seven men.
Seven men.
Walking fast and got into Cristobal's office that was next to me, my left. And they invited them to go to a small room for an interview. I thought immediately, something is wrong. Because Cristobal spoke with others about those ideas. And those people called Bethel, but he didn't know neither me. So they interviewed him and his wife. At the end of the meeting, they came walking in, and I thought, something, I have to talk to him. But and suddenly they came to my office, invited me and Tony.
Well, I think you're too kind using the word invite. I think demand. Demanded.
Yeah, demanded. Yeah, that's, you are right. Demanded us.
And this is something that would probably terrify. It would me. Did it terrify you? Yeah. Scared.
Oh, yes. When we got there, we were scared already. Uh-huh. Because the environment, they were very demanding, very, very strong, their faces. And they immediately said, we are here because the governing body invited us, assigned us, they appointed us to be a committee for you.
Wow.
And your wife. For me.
No announcement ahead of time.
No. Just there. For me, why?
That was a privilege.
Yeah. So they started with the idea that I was covering over an apostasy movement. I explained I didn't know of any movement. So they asked me if I had spoken with him in France. Of course, many times, several times. What about? I said, hold on. My conversation with my friends are private. Those are personal issues, and I'm not going to tell you what I spoke with him. And but they keep moving around, and pressing on. The issue was they asked questions first to Tony about the meeting, what she cooked, everything. And they knew everything. That's something important. They knew everything. They knew what we ate, that we drank wine.
Wow.
They knew everything. At the moment, I asked them, how do you know all those things? And they told me, we are the one that asked questions, not you.
Wow.
It was a very...
And just like in that movie, Big Business, that woman, when they... I don't know if you've seen the movie Big Business. She said, I bet you guys even know I've got my Tuesday panties on.
Okay.
Yeah, something like that.
Like that. But they were so cruel, so... Yeah. Amenazantes.
They always can't think of the word right now.
They were always
threatening.
You're going to be his fellows. You're going to be this and this.
One guy I remember you mentioned in a previous interview. You said he sat up with up on the chair with his foot on the desk with his foot on the chair to be higher than you.
Yes,
like Gestapo was it?
Yes. Goes,
so you know, and that's a tactic. I mean, being in business, I've went into some high-priced attorneys, and I've been in places where the client sits down at a chair lower and the attorney sits higher, and that's all to do something with the mind.
Yes. But the point is that I was scared. I have to say, I was there sitting with them, and always the same issue again and again and again. I asked them. I mentioned to them several times, if you want to know what he wants, I mean, what he believes, talk to him. Ask him. If you want to know what I believe, ask me. But they never asked me.
They didn't care about what you believe.
No, they wanted to. They were after Ray. Yeah. So that continued for a week. Every afternoon, they used to get me there. After the second time I mentioned, don't bring Tony anymore here. Because it was hard for her.
Now, when all this happened, was this after Raymond had left?
Yeah, he was. No.
He was still there. Vacation. Yeah.
He was on vacation.
He was on vacation. He was on vacation, but he was still a member of the governing body.
Yes.
Okay.
So we keep moving, and no result for them. And they were angry. At the end, they were angry. They were so angry that at the moment, I felt like abused. And I remember that I mentioned to one, you stop talking to me like that because I am an elder here, the same as you. Exactly. Don't talk to me like that. And then they reframe it.
Because they said that you would be outside
out on the street.
Yeah. Out in the street with signs, just like those other crazy people. Every day there was somebody in front of Bethel with a sign. So they said that to you, that you would be doing the same thing.
Yeah. So I go,
they didn't know you. They didn't know you guys would go live your life, did they?
No, it was the ones that were in the committee didn't know my personality or neither, my taste and my way of being. So at the moment, I mentioned I have been faithful to the organization for a while, even for a long time. You have to be respectful to me also. Because I remember many occasions during those meetings, myself in Spain, talking to elders, be kind, be nice. When you make the interviews, talk to them nicely, trying to help them. And there I am myself with those people.
The stick, but not treated the same.
No. Uh-huh. So I remember the Thursday night, I called Raymond. I was already like mentally tired and emotionally tired. It was
worn down.
You cannot imagine the pressure that these people put on me. So on Thursday night, I called Raymond Franz. I had his number. I don't know why he gave it to me before he left. So I called him. I said, Raymond, this is really rough. What they want is me to talk against you. And he said, but do it, Nestor. Don't worry. They know what I believe. Talk to them. Don't keep undergoing that. But I said, no, it's my personality, my personal belief, my integrity as a human being. I can't talk about my conversation with friends. If I talk to them about those conversations, then I will feel bad because I will be losing my sense of integrity. And dignity.
You're a good man, Nestor. You remind me so much of another translator from Watchtower. I'm not going to name his last name, but mm-hmm. I mentioned him earlier to you. His first name is Ross. Mm-hmm. He is a circuit overseer later in the Spanish circuits. But I called him after my trip to see my daughter recently, thinking, you know, maybe he could be a mediator and talk to her if she won't talk to us. Mm-hmm. But I told him, I said, I've never been disfellowshipped, Ross. I hope that maybe you'll still talk to me even if it's in private, you know, if my name ever gets publicly announced. And I was shocked. You know what he said? He said, no, Randy, I won't do it in private. Love does not go in private. Mm-hmm. I will talk to you in public. I mean, here he's an active Jehovah's Witness now, but he's a man of integrity like you, and that's how he felt. As a matter of fact, I remember so much because I was talking about to him a dear sister that was special pioneer that was very bad straits. She was literally freezing to death in the wintertime and in the summer. I mean, little 10-foot long travel trailers. But he says, that makes me so angry because this Watchtower Society puts these young, able-bodied circuit overseers in apartments. They build apartments for them, and they don't take care of these older people who have served their lives. And he could say that because, like you, he was a circuit overseer. Yeah. I couldn't say anything like that because it looked like I'm just grumbling. But he could say that. So, you know, you're a good man. Yes. You're a good man, Nestor.
Thank you.
You're a good woman, too. Thank you.
So, on Friday afternoon, we got there again. And they always call Cristobal first, and then Cristobal passed by, and I think he made the sign like giving me a message. But then they came immediately after me. We went there. This time they were more like sad, and they again asked me if I want to cooperate. They were giving me the last opportunity to be obedient to the governing body, that they were acting in their behalf.
They already had their mind made up.
Yeah. So at the end of the meeting, they said, okay, then, you are this fellowship. I remember asking, the fellowship, man? It's like everything for me, the fellowship. Why? I am not aware of committing any sin, anything against Jehovah. Said, but you are this fellowship because you are covering over an apostasy movement. If you get repentant, you can appeal of this decision. And then I said, okay, then I appeal. So that night, I went to a room. I mean, we went to the room. You can imagine how we felt. So many years serving what we thought it was serving Jehovah and his organization, and now I am out for nothing. Because I never made any mistake in my mind. I mean, I was not aware of doing anything wrong. So I made a note, a simple note, that I want to appeal. I am not sure now if they told me to leave it to them before I left, before I leave. So the point is that at that night, I received a letter that I was in fellowship, and now listen to this. They were disfellowshipping me for covering over an apostasy movement. And the letter was signed by the governing body. The governing body disfellowshipped me. And then they mentioned that if I ever get repented and I wanted to return to the organization, I had to write directly to them, not to a congregation. That means that I have the privilege and the honor to be thrown out of the organization directly by the governing body. That means that Jehovah did it through them.
That also means you can't go back because they're not alive anymore.
Well, you know, the thing is, for those people who might be not Jehovah's Witnesses or newly becoming Jehovah's Witnesses, this just shows you're not allowed to be a private person. You're not allowed to keep things private, confidential. You're not allowed to even have a different opinion on a doctrine or anything. No. You've got to, when they say jump, how high, you know?
Yeah, that's how it is. Yeah.
The point is that that night, we want to celebrate this fellowship, man. We were happy that they did for us what we were not able to do at the beginning. So I think that I couldn't stand to be going again to a kingdom hall. Mm-hmm. But they disfellowship us, and we thought it was a favor that they made to us. And we went to a Spanish restaurant to eat paella that night. We were the four of us. And we went there, and we ate paella, and we drank some wine, and we returned. And then we packed to go. But then that same night, I remember telling Tony, we are out. We are not going to be satellites at the organization. I started using that word, that is satellite. Because remember, at that time was the Cold War. Mm-hmm. And I remember listening in the radio and the TV that in Russia there were many. They used to be called Soviet republics. Remember, it was not a country. Mm-hmm. It was not Russia. It was many countries. Mm-hmm. And some of them, they were satellites mm-hmm. of Russia. I mean, that they depend.
Right.
Like the moon depends on the sun,
right.
But we gravitate around the moon. I thought I am not going to gravitate around the Watchtower Society. We are out. I always used to say we are not satellite. So when we left, you want me to tell you what we did?
Yes, please. I hate to ask the sad question, but now we're getting to the sad part too. But you go ahead with what you were going to say. But then I'd like to hear what your father-in-law said to you, either you or Tony,
okay.
But go ahead and tell what you were going to say first, what y'all did.
That we left, and when we left. We put aside behind us all the organization, all the Watchtower. We got rid of Gilead diplomas, letter from the society, whatever.
Pictures.
We eliminate all those things. Even we use a big Bible in Gilead.
It didn't weigh you down anymore.
No. I got rid of of those things, and we went to Puerto Rico without baggage.
The day after we were disfellowshipped, we went downstairs with our stuff. My sister came to pick us up. She lived in Long Island, her and her husband, and she was not a witness. She'd never been. And they couldn't believe when we told them. My brother-in-law started crying. And he said, "How can they do this to you?" But the thing was, it was a rainy day, and we were out on the street and with our stuff, and everybody was going by because they were going to work, and nobody stopped to help to do anything. So, I mean, we were really, it was like one day in and one day out.
You know, at least you were fortunate to get to pack your own stuff. I interviewed and became friends with some original Bible students back, in the day.
Uh-huh.
And they said their stuff was out on the curb when they got back, sitting out on the street.
Really? Wow.
Yes. Yes.
Wow. Yeah, that's the witch tower. That's the the way of doing things.
Then we went to see my parents. We went to see my parents in Georgia before we went on to Puerto Rico.
The circuit overseer dad.
Yeah, at that time he was a special pioneer.
Because health problems.
And, yeah. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, they were elderly. Mm-hmm. And he just, when Nestor started talking to him, he just got up and said, "You've lost your love for Jehovah, and that's it. Well, if you don't come back, then we have nothing more to say."
Oh, I'm so sorry.
And he left, and he went upstairs to his bedroom. And here we were in the living room alone. So we went to bed and left the next day. They took us to the airport, but everything was very cold and
had to be horrible to both of you.
Yeah,
emotionally.
And then he would call us every day. He would call me every day, telling me that my mother was going to die and it was going to be my fault because she would cry every night. And if I didn't come back, she was going to die.
Blame the victims.
So I tried to be nice to him and I said, I'm really very sorry. But I can't live my mother's life, and I can't live your life. This is my life, and I have to live it my way. And you have to understand that, too, I said. So whatever I can do, you let me know, but not go back to that organization. I don't want to go back there. So then for the next 30 years, it was maybe once, twice a year they would call me, especially for my anniversary. I don't know why, but for my anniversary, they would call or send me a little gift, and I would send them when they had their anniversary. But it was always a very cold situation, very indifferent.
Well, they were victims of Stockholm syndrome.
Yes,
they still loved you.
Yes,
fear, they just.
Couldn't
do it.
They were very loyal to the
earth. He passed away.
He passed away, yeah. And then my mother got very sick and, I'm sorry. My sister-in-law couldn't have her any longer.
She was staying with your sister-in-law.
With my sister-in-law, yeah. And then my sister-in-law couldn't have her any longer, so she had nowhere else to go.
She was a Jehovah's Witness, your sister-in-law.
Yes, yes. My sister then went to get my mother, but my sister was very sick. So she finally had to come and live with us, but not before she had to go to the branch office and find out if she could live with us.
She had to get their sanction.
Approval. Yes. And
she was scared.
So they asked her, "Do you have anyone else to go to live with?" She said, "No." To this day, I think, you know, all those years they were in full-time service and no brother or no sister could pick them up and have them in their home.
And your sister-in-law, is she still living?
She's sick. She's sick though, yeah.
She has lupus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but I was happy that no one else wanted her because I wanted her. And when she came to live with us, she kept saying, "If I had known before, if only I had known before." Those were part of her words. And many times she would ask Nestor to pray for her.
I'm so happy that you got, it's a short time.
Nine months. They were glorious.
I'm so
9 months.
That you got that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Happy.
So am I.
Yeah.
See, because the funny thing is that I met her before I met Tony. And we have a very good friendship, good. And her brother was like my brother. We used to call us brother each other. And she suffered, and I suffered. I mean, we both suffered. But then she realized that what she has heard wasn't true, that we were normal people living together very happily.
You didn't have horns coming.
No.
even the witnesses that would go visit her when she was sick, they couldn't get over how nice we were to them. And they would ask us, "When are you coming back?" And, of course, we would say, "No, don't depend on that."
Yeah. You want me to keep talking about what happened to her and us?
Go ahead.
Okay. It's very interesting because it was very good for us. She fell down at home. And she needed a replacement, a hip replacement. So I told her, "You don't have to worry about anything. I will protect you and I will follow your instructions. Remember that they used to have a letter or a card,
yes,
about card. Not using the blood. I'm going to respect your ideas, and I will talk to them. Don't worry. And she said, no, because there is a committee in the branch that they will come. She said, you don't worry. I don't need any committee. We will talk. So we went to the hospital. There was the issue because they were going to do the operation, and I went to talk to the brothers from the branch, the committee came. I knew all of them, and they knew me.
They knew us. Yeah.
From the time that I used to be a special pioneer there.
Mm-hmm.
And they were very nice, very respectful, and one of them said he was going to talk to the doctor, and then I said, no, please, don't do it. I do it. And you don't have to worry. We are going to respect her, but we do the things our way. And they respected it. I didn't want them to take the lead. So I went to talk to the anesthesiologist. And he said, because I started talking to him about her, said, but I am not a witness. I am not a witness. Don't worry about that. And he said, I am so happy that they didn't come because they started using the Bible and those things. I am not going to... I don't need to use blood. Don't worry.
Okay.
No need for the blood. Be relaxed about that. But he said, she has to sign, not you, because she's her daughter. So no problem with that. And we need an affidavit from a lawyer. So we returned to the room. We mentioned that to her. And the brothers were still there. They said, no, we have a lawyer that can do it. But let Tony talk about it.
Yeah, because the lawyer said, well, you're not related directly.
He told me that, yeah.
So, but he got kind of a little nasty about it. So I said, look, I'm a realtor. I have my own business, and I have plenty of lawyers that would be more than happy to help me with this. So I don't need you. Thank you. Well. That was it.
I bet their mouth dropped open.
She was mad. She got mad, yeah. Because he didn't want to talk to me anymore.
Yeah.
I was not related to her. So everything went fine, and she was so happy. The brother from the ranch, one of them, the leader, he said, Nestor, when are you coming back? When are you coming back? I said, no, no way. I'm not going back. And my mother-in-law was so happy that everything went so smooth. She started to realize that she can depend.
Can yeah. That, so it was her needing the hip replacement,
yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
It was,
okay.
That she can depend on us and be happy. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Let me tell you one experience that is interesting, that I think is important for all the ex-witnesses. From that time onward, she started going down. And my mother-in-law, she was a wonderful person, brilliant, very nice, like her daughter. Very, very nice. She, very loving kindness. She was at the hospital. The nurses used to visit her, and she would hold her hands and say, thank you very much. So you're nice. That was her personality.
I wish I could have known her.
yes. You were getting in love with her. So I told her, you can invite your brothers to come here. Here you have a room. It's all for you. You can invite them. They can get in. They can talk. And they can. You can do whatever you want there. And every time that you can go, want to go to the meeting, I will take you. And she can take you back. If not, I go and pick you up. So she was very relaxed from that point of view. And they started coming. But I noticed that some of them, they didn't want to say hello. So one day I was in the dining room. And one of them came in. Tony went out. Tony said, come in. And when he was getting in, I just naturally wake up. I say hello, and I shake hands with him. I mean, I tried. And he told me, you know that you cannot say hello to me. You cannot talk to me. I said, what are you talking to? What are you saying? You are in my home. And in my home, I have some rules. And this is just normal to say hello to the people, invite them to get in. And I say hello to the people in my home. And if you are in my home, you have to follow the rules. Yeah, but I didn't think that it came out.
He's not in the kingdom hall now.
Yeah.
That's like a video guy was filming these at the carts, and the lady says, the sister says, you can't film me. You can't. He says, lady, this is a free filming area, a free zone. I'm allowed to. If you don't want to be filmed, go back to your home or your kingdom halls and lock the doors.
Yeah. So I told him, if you want to come here, you follow my rules in the home. No, he got in. He got in. I talked to him.
Mother, yeah.
He returned. He didn't return. And
he was probably scared to death too.
Yes. But then later on, I realized it's funny. These people come to my home and they want me to follow their instructions.
Yeah.
Because this is something I never felt shunned. I never felt this fellowship. I thought I wanted to go to leave. I put the announcement before, and they throw me out. Why? Because they didn't want me to influence in others. They knew that if I get to call to Spain and tell the branch overseer and others what happened, I would be a bad influence in them.
Yeah.
So they did fellowship and immediately started saying bad things against me. They have mentioned many, many bad things that I learned later on through the years about me that were not true. But here we are, very happy.
So you didn't let them have power over you.
Oh, no way. No way.
That's the important thing.
No way. I was always a human being with all my dignity and gave it to others, that dignity.
And tell again the name of your book, Nestor.
Helping Others.
Helping Others. It'll be coming out really, really soon. And when it does, everybody will want to get a copy. I'd like to just mention a little bit about how important I think his book is going to be to everybody, because we all know how important Raymond's books were, Crisis of Conscience and the Christian Freedom books. And right now there's a big rift, there's a big debate, and I'm not saying this to cause a debate and everything, but right now there's some who are aggravated because they're not in print, and there are some even condoning piracy of it. Some's even bragging about pirating it. They're bragging about it on video, yeah. But whether you're on that side of the fence or this side of the whether you say you think it's okay or because the good outweighs the bad, or whether you think, no, it should never, they both sides of the fence have one thing they can agree on, is those books help people. And it is so very disheartening that there's a lot of people can't afford. You know, I looked up the Christian Freedom book. We have a hardback, but you know what the softback's selling for? $453. $453. Not everybody can afford that now. And it's I don't know how what the Crisis of Conscience book is. But anyway, I feel like that your book is going to really help current Jehovah's Witnesses and those that just, that's got their doubts, that wants to come out. Terry, he was a full-time pioneer, had a lot of Bible studies. We helped unwitness, if you call it that, to him, and helped him out. I gave him a book of Stephen Hassan, the famous expert on cults. He studied it. He read The Crisis of Conscience. He read The Christian Freedom. And here's what he told me. He's kind of chastising me a little bit because I had to confess to him, well, I didn't read the book through. I kind of skimmed it. Randy, I encourage you to read it, especially the Christian Freedom book. I'm in my second time of reading it through.
Wow.
Everybody, he says, you know, YouTubers, you guys, YouTubes out there, he says, y'all do good. Some of them do. Some of them don't. Some people scares them away. But he says, none of the YouTube can do as good as books can. And I think that's why your book, I think, is very important. I think we can't wait to get it. Maybe I'll get you to autograph it, both of you.
Wow.
We'll be
the book, what I like of the book is that I thought that originally. When I started, when Barbara called me, all those years, I was out. We were good people, we were doing good things and doing our business, living our life. We used to party a lot, always together. We used to go dance and things like that. But together with friends,
you hear that, Miranda?
With good friends.
Fellow dancers, Miranda, yeah. The camera woman today, by the way, everybody.
But then Barbara called me and said, no, you have to do it. And I had a chapter that I wrote them, and because somebody, you were reading the book, asked me to write a book. So I started writing it. But then when Barbara called me, everything got a different shape. more formal. But the book is like a story. I don't teach anything. I don't say too many things, but I tell our story.
Present the facts.
Our story, since I was a special pioneer, when I met Tony, that she was a special pioneer. No, I mean, I was a Bible study servant in the congregation. Then I met Tony. I became a special pioneer. We keep together. We went to Gilead. And through the stories, people can see what kind of organization they have. Because I make some good stories there. The sacrifice that the people made in Spain to satisfy the watchtower, that was terrible. Their sacrifices. And then in Gilead, then in Bethel. So the people can see by themselves. And those stories are true. I mean, that's what is going on there constantly. Mm-hmm. And now it's worse, I understand. Right? Now it's worse. So people can see and they can decide.
Well, thank you so much, Nestor and Tony. And is it okay if we get back and do another short video again?
It would be my pleasure.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And we'll see everybody later. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.